regular scheduled program here. Before we get started, because we didn't do it earlier, you know, we have the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Alrighty. So we have a pretty good agenda for tonight. We're gonna try to move through it as effectively, efficiently as possible. But before we do, I'm going to tell you that the last item before adjournment, the new business liaison reports, I don't think we're gonna have a lot of time for that tonight. So we will do that, move that to the agenda for the next meeting. And I'm gonna ask you if you have anything to report from any of your respective committees or PTOs. I'll give you each 2 minutes or so to report back anything that you think is worth your bringing. No, no, this is for next meeting. Okay? So we're gonna move on now just to the superintendent's report.
Great, thank you.
Alright.
Alright, so first, I want to let you know what the search timeline is for our first and middle school principal search. So as you know, we have Mr. Janetti, who is our interim principal this year at Thurston, and we will be starting the search for a permanent principal this winter. So I've given you a timeline in your packet. We'll be posting the position in the middle of December with application deadline of January 22nd. During that time, we'll be recruiting people to serve on the interview committee, so that will include faculty members, parents will be looking for a school committee representative as well. In late January, we'll be doing the paper screen of candidate paperwork and identifying candidates for initial interviews. A team of administrators will be conducting initial interviews. This is a small change from the process that we've done in the past for principal searches. And my thinking here is that I would just like to have the opportunity to see more candidates. So it will give me a chance to actually speak to more people than we have in the past. From there, we'll identify some semi-finalists who will interview with the entire committee. And the semi-finalists, the committee will identify, we hope, three finalists who will then visit the school on February 13th, 14th, and 15th with the appointee announced by approximately March 1st. So we have an early and kind of aggressive timeline, and that's because we want to make sure that we get a really good candidate pool for the search.
Why is there such a, this 2 weeks between when you're going to...
Vacation week.
There's a vacation week in there. Yeah, so
we don't want to lose anyone, right?
No, so, the finalists will be there the week before vacation, and then that will give me vacation week to reference check and do all those other things. March 1st appointment. Okay, great. Secondly, I just wanted to give you a brief update on Westwood High School's J-term pilot. J-term is June term, and this is a new elective program that we're piloting the last 4.5 days of the school year, where students are going to have an opportunity to choose a course that they can immerse themselves in for 4.5 days. I've spoken previously to the committee about it. I do want to remind you that this program is in part possible because we got a very generous grant from the Westwood Education Foundation so that we can do this. We have a steering committee of faculty members and administrators who have been working on this project, and Mr. Donahue is your school committee liaison to that J-term steering committee, so thank you. He's been attending a lot of meetings recently. Last spring, we had teams of teachers who began developing possible courses. In the spring, we are very busy doing focus groups with students, surveying students, getting their feedback about potential courses. And based on that process, we winnowed it down to what is now a list of 37 electives that are very far along in the design process. This fall, we launched J-term with students. So Sean spoke to students at the beginning of the year. We've communicated with parents via the principal's newsletter. We had a J-term launch at curriculum night where parents were invited to come in and hear about it. And see materials. We have a JTERM website that I sent you the link to. Danielle, our school committee rep, has done a very nice article for the student paper about JTERM. So there has been a lot of discussion, a lot of buzz, and I am excited to tell you that we have been getting really great feedback from both students and parents about this. So there's a high level of excitement, which is fantastic. Coming up, we have what we're calling a shopping period this coming Monday and Tuesday. So all students were given the opportunity to select 8 courses that they're going to be shopping. So they're going to go to 10-minute presentations to hear all about the course. It's because our goal for JTERM is to make sure that every kid finds the course that's the exact right match for them so that it's something that they are really going to have a wonderful experience in. And then based on that shopping period, they will be asked to make their actual course selections right after Thanksgiving. And we should know by sometime in December what courses people are enrolled in for June. So things are heating up and really exciting right now. I also just want to mention that, you know, I've spoken previously about the fact that JTERM, we have all kinds of academic goals for students around JTERM, but that the project itself is related to some professional development that we're doing with teachers as well. So the process of designing the courses has been really important in terms of our PD focus, thinking about project-based learning, thinking about curriculum design, doing feedback protocols with each other. And so from my perspective, the professional development value has, it's actually exceeded my expectations at this point in the process. So,
this is Emily, yes. Too. I mean, it's been a pleasure to sit in on the meetings. It's a, you and Allison have together with a very professional operation, just coming up with 30 creative things the kids would want to do all week, every day. Mm-hmm. And I just encourage school committee members to look on the website. Just to look at the description of the courses, I mean, the only problem is most of us would want to take them. You know, all kinds of people want to get into the courses, but really I want to congratulate you on taking an idea to a very, very professional product. And I think the kids are going to be thrilled to learn this way.
Thank you. Yeah, we're really excited about it. And of course, one of the things that we're talking about a lot at the steering committee is how will we assess the value of the program? How will we know how it's gone, if we want to do it again. So we are actively thinking about those kinds of issues. And then I wanted to update you on our upcoming program for students on November 28th as part of the high school's Courageous Conversations Initiative. We have a woman visiting, her name is Marian Blumenthal-Lazan, and she is a Holocaust survivor. When she was 9 years old, she was incarcerated at Bergen-Belsen. And she has written a book, and she goes out and she speaks with student groups about her experience and her family's experience. And so she will be visiting the district on November 28th. She is going to be doing an assembly for high school students and then also for middle school students. So there are going to be 2 separate presentations that day. We are communicating with parents about the program so they will know what is happening. At the middle school, there are going to be some preview discussion about the program with kids and making some connections to the curriculum there at the middle school. And then at both the middle school and the high school, there will be opportunities for students to then debrief with teachers after the program about what they've heard and you know, what meaning they make of it. So I think that this is going to be a really important event for our students, and I want to thank some folks at the high school. This Courageous Conversations initiative is actually something that came out of a student think tank. So about 30 kids got together with teachers and administrators last spring, and they were talking about things that they wanted to have an opportunity to hear about and discuss, and this was a program that came out of that process with students. And finally, I did not have on the agenda, but I want to mention 2 good news things with students. So first, we have some students in our BioBuilders Club. Is this going to come up here? What do I need to do to make this happen? There we go. So we have an extracurricular activity at the high school called BioBuilders, and it's a group of kids who are interested in synthetic biology. please don't ask me to explain what that is. So, but I heard their presentation last spring. They did a presentation for faculty about what they were working on, and they have now gotten published. So, I'm gonna get my notes here so I get this right. So, they last year were designing something to modify yeast to more efficiently produce bioethanol. And the write-up of their design has been published in the most recent issue of BioTrex, which is an international peer-reviewed synthetic biology journal for high school students. So we are, and their names of the authors are up here on the screen. We're very proud of these kids. And I don't know what the next step for them is, if they're actually gonna go into some kind of
build a system.
They're gonna do it. Okay.
Is this an extracurricular, or is this part of a class?
It's a club.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a club. So if you wanna read their journal article, here it is. I started it. It is dense, a lot about enzymes and whatnot, but it's interesting, and there are some very complicated diagrams. But it's great work.
And they started a course, like a biology course, and they met.
So there are kids who are at the high school who are very interested in science, and we have two biology teachers, Ms. Armstrong and Dr. Miller, who are the advisors of the club. And the woman who is in charge of BioBuilders in general is out of MIT, I think. Is that right? I met her. And the club formed about a year ago. And last year they identified something that they wanted to design, and this was what they took home. It's really neat stuff. Really neat stuff. And finally, I just wanted to mention that our girls cross country team won the 2017 MIA East Girls Division IV Cross Country Championship. So, congratulations to them. We're very proud. With your permission, I might invite them in for next month.
Yes, we should do that and recognize
them.
Your hard work. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, at this point in the program, we're going to open the floor up to public participation. If anybody has anything from the public here, this is your time to ask us some questions or make some comments, anything related to the schools. No? Okay. Great, moving on then, thank you. All right, folks, we're on to discussion items. So the first topic of discussion are the MCAS results. You know, there was, I know you're gonna do a report on the MCAS, and I sent you, which you probably saw on the globe. Did you see the text that I forwarded to you?
Oh, I did, yes.
From one of our teachers. So. Yes. Just for perspective, and I'll send it to the rest of you, but there was a very, very nice, what do we call it? Was it an op-ed?
Letter
to the editor in the Boston Globe from Mr. Kulik here in middle school.
Uh-huh.
He was one of the most revered teachers, I think, in the district,
right.
And wrote a very nice piece about, gave some perspective with regard to MCAS and what teachers were really here for, and not to teach the test and so forth. But I'll forward it out to the rest of you. I thought it was actually another parent that sent it to me. So with that, though, we know the MCAS is still very important, and he wasn't saying it wasn't, but he provided some good perspective.
Well,
he might have
said it wasn't,
but kind of. But
he's got a good skin. He's been around long enough.
Yes.
So I know we have a long agenda, and in the interest of kind of getting right into it, I'm going to get right into it.
Sure.
The presentation tonight, I have kind of five parts to it. I do want to take a few minutes just to talk about what happened last year in terms of what tests were actually given, because it is a little bit complex. I'm going to give you the 2017 highlight reel. What's the great news that came out of this test session, and what we're proud of. We'll take some time to look at some comp data. I want to update you about what has happened at the district level in terms of analysis, kind of what we do with the detailed information we look at, and then forecast some next steps. That's it in a nutshell. So you may have heard these terms thrown around. There were actually two different types of MCAS tests given last year. There was the legacy test. That's the test that's been given since way back in the day, in 1998, when we first started doing this with students. and something that's been called either MCAS 2.0 or the next generation test. And there's a lot of history to why this has happened, but in a nutshell, the next generation test is a test that's aligned with newer state standards. It's the test that has replaced the PARC, and you remember how well that went, right? The PARC happened, there was a lot of hue and cry and protests and opt-out, and part of that came from the fact that the PARC assessment wasn't truly geared toward Massachusetts. It was a test that was given in a number of different states that signed on together as a consortium. It was kind of an efficiency measure. So Massachusetts, among many states, has voted back in 2011 to sign on to the Common Core in part, but our standards aren't exactly the Common Core standards. They're sort of the Common Core, but then we sort of updated them and made them work for Massachusetts. That PARC test didn't reflect those nuances at all, and so students were taking tests with questions on them that weren't a nice match. And in addition, there were a whole bunch of other things about that test that people just didn't like. The commissioner recommended to the Board of Ed that we replace it with this MCAS 2.0. The Board of Ed opted to do that. And so this past year was the very first year that those next generation tests were given. And in fact, we had two things going on simultaneously. So in 10th grade, and as well as in the science test, we used the old version. Those are the legacy tests, the ones pencil and paper and bubbles and all that kind of stuff. So those are still in place at those levels. At the other levels, so 3 through 8, math and English, were all these newfangled next generation tests. And this is kind of a hybrid of the old and the new MCAS, or the old MCAS and some of the features of PARC tests too. They were offered as either computer-based or paper-based last year, although they are designed really to be a computer-based test, and we were encouraged to do that. And we did do that at almost every grade level. 2 grade levels, we had students. Should come back soon. Grade 6 and 7 math took it on paper. And then there are a handful of students throughout the district who took the paper test as an accommodation because of an IEP reason. So for some students, the paper-based test just works better. One thing I do want to emphasize, though, is that it is a kind of redone test. And the state actually sent out quite a bit of information publicizing the fact that this is a new thing with new standards, with new kind of scoring mechanisms. And because of that, we're seeing some changes.
No pressure.
Is there an expectation that a certain
mean, you don't want a test that's too easy, but you also don't want one that tests that's too hard. So is there an expectation that there should be a certain percentage in advanced and proficient and needs improvement, or how do you gauge whether the test is appropriate or not, and are we?
So there's it's a great question. The folks who design these tests have always asserted that they are criterion reference, not normative reference, which basically means we're not trying to do a bell curve. What we want is to really know and understand the standard and set the sort of cut scores so that they really truly show us students meeting the standard with the goal of getting more and more students to that standard over time. So that's the theory. I haven't been on the inside of that process, so I can't speak to whether it is true in reality or not. I do know when the first MCAS wave of testing happened, the scores seemed shockingly low at first, and then everything kind of calibrated. So that's what we've seen historically.
Yeah, that was not my question. So.
Did I steal your question?
You stole my question?
Please go first.
Sorry.
So also on the horizon, the high school test is going to be redesigned. This new next generation test was not given at the high school level. It's going to be piloted. Questions will be piloted throughout the Commonwealth this year. And then our current freshmen, class of 2021, they'll be the first group to take that test next year. Now, the good news is the governor, not the governor, commissioner, acting commissioner Wolfson, has recommended that we make sure that our kind of rates of median proficiency don't shift radically for this group of kids. So we have many of our kids, you know, the overwhelming majority of our kids are passing this at the first go. That will not change for at least our ninth graders. However, he has stated they may go through this sort of recalibration process for other groups of students. So our eighth graders, seventh graders, sixth graders. So this is something on our radar we're going to have to be mindful of and look at moving forward.
If I just underscore, that's particularly important because the grade 10 test is the competency determination to decide whether or not you're eligible for diploma.
Yes.
So where that standard gets set is, you know, highly relevant.
Right. And we will need to be thoughtful about our response to that because we want to make sure our kids who work hard and, you know, really deserve a high school diploma have every opportunity to get. Also coming soon, new science tests. As you know, we changed science standards and there's just a phase-in process. So this past year, we had the old standard on the test. This year, they'll be overlapping, so just the things that were the same on the old standards and the new standards. And then by 2019, the science test will completely reflect the new 2016 science standards. At the high school level in science, all it says, all I've been able to get is it's still in a review, so who knows? That could take a while. I think the social studies assessment question has been under review for, I think, 15 years. Mm-hmm. All right, this is the highlight reel. This is the good part. I don't actually have video footage. That would be really cool. So first off, Westwood High School was one of just 7 schools that earned commendations for performance. And none of those other schools are in this area. It's kind of a new thing for us. And the high school is commended in 2 out of 3 possible categories. One was high achievement. Show you up there kind of where that calculation is. PPI, that number is created by looking back 4 years and looking at over time progress toward getting kids to proficiency. That's what that number represents. The high progress has to do with student growth percentile, which is a number that's attached to individual students that measures kind of how a student grew over the course of a year. The way they come at that number is kind of interesting. They actually take a student and put them into a bucket with a whole bunch of other students with similar backgrounds, so similar score profiles. So if I got proficient 4 times in a row, I'd be in that bucket with those other kids. And then they would look at this year's scores and see, and put me on a scale as how they compared to other kids like me. So that was great news. A huge great news from my perspective. I mean, watched the work firsthand, was a massive improvement in our 8th grade science scores. We saw, I put up here the 15-16, you can even go back a few more years, 14-13. We've really not been performing in a way that we think reflects the work our teachers do or our students do. And this year jumped up significantly in science. And I think there are 2 things going on that explain that change. One is, there's been a huge effort over the course of the last 18 months to tackle some much-needed curriculum alignment, and that seems to be working. The other thing is, as you know, the science test in eighth grade, as well as the science test in fifth grade, is not just about 1 year's worth of concepts. It goes back 3 years. And so our kind of without doing what I think of as kind of gross test prep stuff, you know, our kids didn't get kind of a big packet. Instead, our science teachers did a pretty thoughtful review of concepts where they gave kids questions like one per week over the course of quite a while to go back and spiral back to those old concepts. And I think that that's a thoughtful way to approach it. If this is stuff kids are supposed to know by the time they leave eighth grade, not a bad idea to review it. Try to keep it light. So that was great. Elementary math, English, and science, all three scored strong across the district. And it was really sort of every grade level, every content area, sort of a phenomenal performance. And when you look at our content, you'll see that those scores are in the kind of top three among our comparable district towns for everything. I think it's particularly impressive to see the scores in science because our elementary school teachers spent a ton of time and energy last year adjusting to a brand new science curriculum. And we weren't sure, you know, sometimes when you're in that, I think Emily talked about this last year, when things are in a state of flux, sometimes the test scores aren't that great. So to have it kind of still be solid in the middle of that, our science coordinator is pretty convinced that the approach that we're taking, which is kind of a really cool hands-on exploratory approach, is something that works really well for a lot of kids. So that's something for every level, which is good. Now this is the comp district data. And these are the charts everybody likes to look at. I'm not a fan of these charts, I'll tell you why. and it's not just because I'm a middle school principal, right? You see this as a sort of notable trend where the scores are up top and all that. But you know, as you see there's a trend and you're gonna notice it over time, each time, Westwood's in the top three at the elementary level. We fall back at middle school, so we slowly climb up and end up kind of in the middle of the pack at high school. So these are the English scores across the board. I do want to point out just how close together things get by the time we get to 10th grade. But I also want to take this up and talk a little bit about this as a data visualization problem.
Can I share one thing? I say this every year. So we call these our comp districts. I don't know in what way they are necessarily comparable, right? I'm not sure what the statistic is. Way back at some point, we started using these districts as comp districts because I believe the FinCom was using them at that time. I don't know if that's still the case or not.
I thought it was because of the letter W.
That might be another factor. I don't know. So I've been saying, I don't know if they are comparative districts. I would say they are districts to which we like to compare ourselves, right? And we keep doing that.
It is an interesting imagining, like, there's something groups that are missing that probably should be there.
Well, it is interesting, too, because if you look at Lexington and Needham, they're significantly bigger, too, just to start. It's not really, but I get it, from an academic standpoint.
Yeah, there's a different set of districts that, so Desi actually has something they call the DART analysis tool, and they have ID'd for us what they believe our comparable districts are in terms of the demographics of the student body, you know, who we have in front of us, and it would be interesting to look at that at some point, too.
This is very quick diversion, but I did want to point out something on the one of the things about those charts, they are great if you're, like, wanting to take a moment to celebrate eating that field or be at the top of the charts. They're nice for that. But they can be really misleading when you just look at them visually, and I'll illustrate really quickly. So, at the top and the bottom, everything is spaced out, so it looks like they're equidistant, and yet the gaps are really different in different places here. So we've got only 2 points between our top two and 10, which is a pretty significant gap between the bottom two. In addition, I'll point out that for us in the middle, we're actually tied, but conveniently put ourselves a little bit ahead of Needham. We like to do that. We could have easily done it this way, right? And there's no real way to visually represent that fairly on this chart. Which is why I like things like this. So this actually gives you the full scale up to 100. And when we think about what the comp data is good for, what it should be really good for is helping us understand, are we in the mix with our comp, with these districts that we like to compare ourselves to? Are we kind of in there in a way, you know, it is all, it's always nice to be Lexington or something like that, that's cool, but, you know, we want to make sure that we're not kind of starting to fall off in this level. An even more kind of fun way to look at it is if you can break it down a little bit by the top two categories, because you can see some interesting things in this data. So this is eighth grade English, and you can really see where the strength is in some districts, and it doesn't show up on those two pure contours. Something I'll continue to encourage you to look at this one going forward. So that's the fifth grade version. And so we just looked at fifth grade. I'll go back to eighth grade for a second, and you'll notice the fifth grade and eighth grade are there. But then when we get to high school, it's interesting to see, basically, everybody's merging on proficiency. That's kind of what happens in the test. And really, the margin of difference is somewhere between Bedford and Bedford. So it's not huge. Even Bedford has math, kind of similar story. We had some very strong kind of top of the chain here. We drop back in sixth grade, so we work our way up toward the middle. I do want to point out with math that the scores, especially in the middle school, they separate out more. There's a little more divergent. And that is something that I do think math is that we should be watching carefully. You can see that. So elementary is pretty close together. And middle school starts to separate out. And that actually is something to look at. But by 10th grade, again, science. A chart I didn't include on here, but I kind of wish I had. One nice piece of that science here, I told you we jumped up a lot last year. Every other district in this group, except for Wayland, actually went the other direction. So our scores improved dramatically over 2015, while our other districts did not. So I feel like something, whatever we're doing, we gotta sort of keep moving in that direction.
Well, I'm gonna throw out a theory, just for the heck of it. So, I mean, I actually think that this is some preliminary evidence that our theory of action around middle school science that we needed to align our curriculum with the standards is working, that we have been for 18 months going at that, and when the, you know, when the assessment came out, we're doing well, whereas other districts you know, went in the other direction at that point, so we need to continue that.
See, I always like to wait for at least 2 years before we get to it.
Correct. Cautiously optimistic. This is where we are.
So again, these charts show kind of similar to what we've seen before, fifth grade. Assessment's doing very well. Eighth grade. So back here, and by the high school. Strong chart. Right. So district analysis, and this is really talking about, well, where do we think we have some room to improve? I took a kind of different approach to what we've tried in the past. I think what we've done in prior years is we've put together teams for each test, so a group of teachers to look at the English data, math data, and science data. This year I asked a group of people to get together who are willing to look at everything, and I kind of advertised specifically and asked for people who were kind of unafraid of looking under all the corners of the thing and could feel very objective about the data and not get overly emotional about it. So, and I got this fantastic group of people. And what we really tried to do is look for a limited number of areas that we could really focus on for improvement. So this, these are sort of our specific goals. One was to look for patterns in the data, including performance gaps among subgroups, and also areas of relative weakness. On the whole, Western does pretty well, so you want to see, are there things that jump out that we're not doing so well, and what does that tell us about kids teaching, what kids learning in our teaching? We wanted to identify a very manageable number of focus areas so we can be strategic and not try and work on everything all at the same time, and then develop an action plan to address those areas. So this group kind of got to those first two things. The third thing is a work in progress, so this is kind of where we are right now. I can give you a little bit of a preview, but we're still sort of working out the details. Key finding number one, math, constructive response or open response, our students' percentage of scoring was lower in these types of questions than it was in the other two types of questions. And I want to say, in all of these findings, our weaknesses are not unique to Westwood. So the things we identified are not really similar to anything happening here. They're happening throughout the state, or they're happening in other districts that are similar. But what this says is that kids are not, they're having a hard time on more complicated math questions, where there's more language involved. They have to break things down and explain more. But the interesting thing about this is the type of math that a lot of kids are going to end up doing in their life. So this is really important stuff. So if we want to really have kids learn to do math that's useful, so we want to have them learn to figure out where is the math in the situation, and how do I solve it, and how do I solve it thoroughly.
So constructive response is?
It's a newfangled term for the open response in math. And basically, it's a multi-part question. Usually, it's a sort of real-world scenario situation, or something that involves a bunch of different steps. So you might have to graph something and explain how that data shows. Kids tend to struggle because, first of all, it's harder. You're not being told up front, here's what the math is. And secondly, they sometimes skip pieces. Some of those problems actually build step to step, too. So if you skip the first part, you kind of, you're out of luck.
Right.
Also, under the math, you know, one of your targets is subgroups.
Yeah.
And one of the charts you handed out, the 3 to 8 year old. 3 to 8 year classes showed a huge difference in the subgroup of the disability group,
mm-hmm.
the African-American group. And so is there an initial focus on those groups also in this math? Can you talk about it?
Yeah, I mean, that skill is something we have to be able to teach everybody. And I think for kids with language-based disabilities in particular, sort of parsing a really wordy problem can be really hard. So part of what we have to figure out is how do we do that? How do we break it down and use the resources we've got to help kids navigate language? So language isn't a thing that they're particularly good at.
We discovered why they're so low in math, the category disabled.
I'll address that a little bit when we get to that next thing.
The non-disabled is 81, yeah. And the students are 25.
Yes,
that's
it's a huge gap.
So it's not just refining it, but
yeah.
Sounds like basics.
It can be a number of different things. So our second finding was really about an English standard. This is the text types and purposes, which is a part within the writing of the test. And basically is asking kids to sort of match up something that they're doing in writing to a specific purpose in a specific text. And that's kind of vague, Sandy, but it's a long standard, so I don't want to get into too much of the details. But essentially, where this crops up is in the writing. One thing about the next generation MCAS is it has a lot more writing on it. Every grade level has an essay, at least one. Every grade level does writing in response to text. They've gotten rid of the good old days when they would just ask you this nice prompt, like, if you could write the President of the United States a letter about anything, what would you say? You know, they would ask kind of cool questions like that. No more. Now you have to read something and write something in response to the reading. So it's a more complex task. And this is just like everywhere else in the state. This is an area where our kids don't get as close to the maximum number of points. It doesn't mean there's anything wrong in Westwood. It just means it's an area where we can improve. And it is an area that's really important. You know, being able to read critically and write appropriately in response is something we want our students to be able to do. And Charlie mentioned subgroups, and I did want to say we had findings around subgroup gaps. I do want to preface this really, really carefully, though. When we talk about subgroups and when we look at subgroups, we do it with the lens of what is it that we can do as a school system to sort of make sure we're doing everything we can to kind of even the playing field for kids and make sure everybody's got a shot. Okay? The reality is we know that there's a lot of talent among all groups of kids that are reported. So the subgroups that get reported on the test are around gender, around income, around race, around special education status. There's also this ELL group. We don't get a lot of information about our ELL students because there's just not enough of them to get reported out. And there's this kind of odd group called high needs, which is a amalgam of a couple other different groups. So when we look at data, we need to be thoughtful about the fact that within those groups, we have students who perform in the advanced category. We have students who perform in the lowest category in every group. The critical part is when we see gaps that are consistent and persistent, we need to reflect on that and figure out how do we provide more support to help more kids get to that proficiency bar. So the gaps that exist tend to exist 3 to 8 pretty widely, and the good news is they do narrow very substantially by the time kids hit the high school, but they don't close all the way. And I think, to Charlie's point, we want to invest some time and energy in figuring out how to see them narrow more quickly, because the more quickly we can get them narrow, the further we can close them.
Could it be possible in the future to begin to, as you're doing the comparative studies, is to look at how other towns are doing with their subgroups? I mean, are we better than, or is there somebody out there that's creative? You know, is that worth beginning to compare a little bit, like science and math for the disability group?
Yeah. I mean, interestingly, one of the towns I would want to look at is Wayland, where they've actually very explicitly, as a town, taken on some of this. You know, but I think it's something you have to kind of take on explicitly and know that that's what you're doing.
Lexington's done a lot of good work too. Closing the achievement gap. I've read some interesting reports that they've produced. And I do want to underscore that, I mean, there's a reason that examining these subgroups and looking at gap narrowing, it's a part of the accountability system for the state, and it's because this issue of achievement gap is, it's not a Westwood issue, it's a national issue, it's a state issue. And we look at these subgroups, we're required to look at these subgroups, and we want to. We want to make sure that we're serving all students well.
Absolutely. I did take a look just for kind of in anticipation of this conversation, just at Needham and Medfield, as kind of two nearby communities that are in those comp towns. And honestly, their kind of patterns are similar. There's not like a particular grade level in the 3 to 8 band. It's fairly wide in that stretch, but in all three towns, things narrow at the high school. I actually think our high school kids, our gaps are smaller than some of our comp towns, which is great. It means by the end of kind of moving through our school system, we're actually doing a pretty good job by our kids. One interesting thing that I didn't put up here, we looked at growth, the student growth percentile ratings, and for a couple of the tests, our kids on IEPs, their growth numbers were higher than the non-IEP kids at the 10th grade level, which is awesome. That's what you would want, right? So finding ways to make sure that the students who are really working harder because they've got a disability that they're having to like grapple with, you know, how do we help them, give them the best shot?
I mean, to Charlie's point, it's some future, not this year. It'd be interesting to have a deep dive on what's actually working. When you've heard about these things are older than God, some of these issues. And so it'd be helpful to actually understand what's going on, what's innovative. Is there some that's really being successful at closing this gap?
Yeah.
What can we bring here?
Absolutely. And I think to the point, you know, stuff that we've written about Lexington, and I know Will has been here for a while. So. All right. Oh, good. We're getting close.
Sure.
Yeah, all right, so next up. I want to share with you kind of what at the district level we do at the culmination of this. You know, our first order of business is to make sure everybody has the information to kind of get the key findings and detailed data out to leadership teams so that they can implement specific actions at the school level. We want to support the curriculum teams in terms of developing action plans around the math piece and the writing piece. Okay. The subgroup piece, you know, part of that is something we tackle through professional development. We might be looking at ways to sort of close that achievement gap by consulting with some of the towns that are doing well. And by kind of using kind of newer or more specialized approaches. Universal design is sort of this notion that came out of architecture originally, which is an idea that you want to try and lesson design up front that gives more kids access right from the get-go. So you're not lowering standards, you're not modifying things after the fact, you're just sort of designing with differences in mind. A good example is, you know, an entryway to a new building. So now we're designing things that are both beautiful and elegant and functional, and everybody can get in, regardless of whether they're in a wheelchair or walking or not. we're going to continue our work in science because we think it's working, and there's some evidence that shows that. And also, based not just on this, but on some other conversations I'm having with leadership throughout the district, we are going to revise the curriculum review cycle and move the English curriculum review up. We actually think there's, it's kind of critical time with that great leadership in place right now. New leadership at the elementary level, the leadership at the high school level, and it's an area where we just feel like getting in there and doing some work would actually pay off. At the school and grade level, people are using MCAS data a little differently than they do at the district level. They're sort of using it to look at individual students and their needs, particularly students where there's been a pattern over the course of several years. You know, is having a hard time meeting proficiency standards more than 1 year and more than 2 years, then isn't currently getting some of the support. We know that something's going on. Where you're planning ahead for those changes that could impact high school competency determination. And then doing that curriculum work around refining how we teach kids to respond to these more complex math problems and lessons learned to write. I want to close with some good news, which is not good. It's doing really well. This, Commonwealth is leading the nation in, on a number of different measures, and it has been for the past several years. It's been number one in NAEP scores for reading math on all levels for several years.
NAEP is the National Assessment of Educational Progress.
Yes.
Those people who don't use that acronym all the time.
I think it's worth noting that they come to Westwood pretty much every other year to test it. So I feel like Westwood's contributing in some useful ways. We've done the first overall scoring state Miss Quality Counts report that's done by EdMeet every year, and we're the top in terms of both ACT and AP scores. And then in this great kind of Commonwealth that we have, Westwood is a high-performing district. It's widely recognized as a good district and a really good state. So it's not a bad place to be. And I say that to kind of keep this in context. Our MCAS scores shouldn't be kind of this sort of Damocles that we worry about. What they really should be is just an opportunity for reflection and growth. And with that in mind, I leave you with Gerald Ford and a little bit about the value of feedback. Right? So having some kind of tangible, visible, objective measure of how you're doing is really helpful. And for us, we are attaining spectators. We're doing better than that. But we need to have some sort of measurement by which we can sort of understand our performance and look for areas for continuing growth.
You said it on the last line, I think, that for those who say two years ago, maybe more, who are not quite just getting to proficient, right?
Yeah.
So what is the, is it 2 years that we watch, and then how do you, what's the process for addressing
that? Well, so I think it's twofold. Parents can know, so we can know, right? It kind of works both directions. Really explicitly this year, we talked to elementary leadership about doing some review of those scores with the teacher team so that we know who are the kids who particularly are in a band where it raises some concerns, and especially if that data is consistent with other data. That
so
data is really inconsistent with what we see on the day-to-day performance, then there might be something else going on around the test.
Because I was going to say, so then what do you do? I mean, is it the general ed teacher, or do you have the right reading specialist, or what, how does it?
Kind of depends. I mean, I think we usually try and start with some in-class interventions or some lower-level interventions first. I think in cases that are really persistent, we've had students who seem by other measures to be doing well, but consistently struggled with MCAS over time, and at a certain point, we end up looking at that as perhaps a special education issue where we want to see, if we really think the student knows things but they aren't able to show those things in this context, then maybe we're missing something
right.
And we need to look more carefully.
If you remember those charts we put together, that are the pyramid charts, the tiers of things, that base could have a lot of both general ed and special ed people kind of collaborating, and then it might break out in either direction depending on how the student responds to what we do to help them. But that's happening already. I mean, that's since these scores have come in, people have started those processes.
Well, it usually happens independently of the scores, too. For most kids, we see things on a day-to-day basis.
Right.
And this sort of reinforces what we see. Anyway, But if it doesn't, that's where we need to be.
Any other questions?
I'd just like to share with you some good news that was brought to my attention, that asked you to thank you for a wonderful presentation, and also not only pointing out good things, but how we've improved. You know, that the science thing that a lot of hard work has put into that we've swung up is a tremendous commitment to changing things. And I also appreciate you pointing out where we're not the best and how we can get there.
There might have been some jumping up and down and excitement in Central Office.
No, there might
have. Maybe.
And just the analysis is wonderful too. Just ended out with something that, this is a group, I don't know how credible they are, called School Digger, and they do statistics. And it's brought to my attention that they look at all the high schools, all the schools in Massachusetts. So Westwood last year was ranked 42nd, and now we're 11th. So it's one of the biggest improvements of any.
Emily, you're amazing.
So we're 11th best.
Too much.
According to them. Now, there's other statistics show we're better. In the elementary area, Deerfield is ranked 5th in all the elementary schools in Massachusetts. Martha Jones, 7th. If Sheehan is ranked 18th. But Martha Jones went from 60th to 7th, from 16 to 17. So it'd be huge, wonderful improvements. The middle school is getting better. That's all I'm saying. But I thank you very much for the presentation.
So I'm going to have to ask. Emily and I had a conversation about this in a meeting. So, look, great news on a lot of fronts. However, the data would indicate that something happens when the kids go from fifth grade to 850 High Street. And I don't know what it is. I know we're gonna get a new principal to go into that. But there is particularly the data in sixth grade. So that's, we don't need to look at it this year, but it's gonna remain on my radar because it's a bit of an anomaly. Like these kids, we were top two in ELA at all three elementary, and then top two, and then we go to like the bottom two from the 10 on the peer group. Math, we're top three all 3 years, and then it goes to dead last among the peer group. Do you have any theories? Do you think that's random, or do you think there's something going on there?
I don't think I have a really form theory. I would say that there, I do think, I would look carefully at the based on my theory, I think we should worry more about math than English, just because we're kind of right in there still with English, but there is this sort of drop-off in math. And, we've talked about a number of things after middle school.
Yeah.
Teachers, core academic teachers would like to see longer classes there. Community units, kids go from 75
in math. Yeah, we have a number of things that we'd like to explore, and schedule is one of them. So at our middle school, we have 42-minute periods, which if you've taught is like, you barely get unpacked before you're packing up again, whereas in the way that we instruct math in the elementary school, you might have like a 75-minute block, right? So I do think that we need to look at some structural things.
Yeah, I get it. We're getting the principal. I get that, too. It should remain on our radar, I guess.
Absolutely. I think the math department has just kind of gotten comfortable with new text series and some new resources that I think are going to be really helpful. I know it's a really thoughtful group of people who are really committed to working on it, so that's very good.
Thank you. Okay, so we're moving on now to the budget calendar and our priorities. So we're going to have a little discussion about.
Well, so the purpose here, I first of all put in your packet the budget calendar for this year. So we sort of outlined what the process will be. And with our target being, of course, that I would present my proposed budget to the school committee in January. And one of the things that we had talked about in our retreat over the summer was making sure that in our budget process this year, we had an opportunity to talk as a group about what priorities the school committee sees in the budget process, so that as we're doing our internal budget development work, we make sure we're kind of on the same page and considering those things. We don't have any confusion in January about that. So I just
wanted to have that discussion tonight. We are clearly already well into our process here internally, with cost center leaders having turned in things to, well, I guess next week, the cost center leaders are turning things into us, but then we will start to look at all of those budget requests as a big picture and starting to try to sort out priorities throughout the month of December. So I will tell you, of course, you know, class size, we always think about that. We think about just program needs, special education. This is clearly something we'll be thinking about. And really, as a leadership team, we're going back to our district improvement goals. So we really have talked about trying to tie our budget requests to those things that we are working on as a district. So we're gonna be looking at that. But I wanted to hear from you if there are specific things you want us to consider. And then the second piece also is that the committee had asked, I think last spring, that if in this budget process we could give you some information about the current status of fees that we collect and tuition, so that you could have that understanding going into the budget process, and specifically to think about other ways that we could start to phase out the kindergarten tuition. So we brought that information to you tonight, and I just need to get a sense from you if in fact that is something that you want us to be thinking about in this budget development process or not. So I don't know where you want to start here.
So I'm turning over to you all for a discussion, right?
And to each other.
Well, thank you for putting that data together. I mean, there was,
thanks,
we didn't know it last
that.
Year, and you really put valuable information together to look at it.
No, go ahead and lead up. Why don't we start with, before we get to the kindergarten issue and the issue of fees, many times over the past few years too, John had, there were the needs and the wants. Some stuck in our craws more than others, and we had unlimited funds. Many of them probably would have been included in our budgets, but if there's anything that you can think of or based on conversations we've had about some of the needs and concerns, you know, science, of course, was a big one, class size and so forth, but is there anything that...
I don't know, Emily, if you could do what John did, which is give us a list of, you know, wants, but we don't think we can afford them out. I mean, that's valuable. From your perspective, we have our own ideas, maybe, but it'd be valuable to hear from you and the teachers, you know, what would be nice someday, but we can't afford it right now to... That would be helpful, because although it caused some trouble last year.
So what are some of the, so you say we have our own, so what, go ahead.
I would love to talk about foreign language in the lower grades. I know that, you know, we always say that foreign language in the lower grades really doesn't accomplish much, but I'm hearing from the districts that the kids are getting, they're getting good curriculum in the lower grades. I think that we need to
schedule together. I'd add to that, you know, a couple of neighboring towns now getting Mandarin down to a low level. I don't know if anyone's interested in it, but it might be worth a survey to see, you know, who would be interested. You know, they might not be interested, but I think it's Medfield that's doing Mandarin in the elementary level.
They're doing Mandarin, they're doing Spanish, so they're doing, and they're doing French, actually. So they're doing three languages, and they start from very early, third grade, I believe.
So what don't they do? If there's only so much time in the day, where do they take out?
I don't know. I mean, that's something that I think we have to look at.
Well, I mean, so I think that there are two different issues here, right? I mean, it has to do with what our instructional and curricular priorities are, so that's number one. And, I mean, the foreign language curriculum review is probably about 5 years old now, so we that in a bit. And the second piece is the budget piece, and where those, you know, where does foreign language fall as a curriculum priority in terms of the budget? And what I would
put inside the budget, though,
yeah.
Let's just, you know, how would you fit it in?
I don't know. I mean, so
how they fit it in. They have to fit it in somehow.
Let's cut something that we do. Those kids don't get recess.
I will call over to Medfield and find out. I mean, as part of our foreign language curriculum review years ago, we did that. We visited all kinds of other communities.
Right.
We took a look at what they were doing. I will go back and read that report
right.
again, and I can call Medfield and find out. Because you're quite right. I mean,
our elementary teachers will tell you they are not feeling like they have an abundance of time in their day, quite the opposite. And so we would need to think really carefully about that issue.
We do have a Mandarin school, the Northwood High School on Sundays, private, we rent the space out to them. And how well does the community know that it is there and it's available for any age groups?
Yeah.
I mean, I think that that'd be the first opportunity, let people go there if they want to learn Mandarin. And if everybody knows about it, then,
but that's,
you know,
not the point, Shelley. I'm talking about looking at introducing foreign language at the lower levels, as other school districts do, as part of the curriculum. Because, I mean, you know, if you, that's an extracurricular thing. That's something that they have to do.
Take advantage of the balls there.
You'd have to have a corresponding high school program. It makes no sense to have Mandarin now.
Well, we have Mandarin.
Right. So if we're going to add something,
right,
you have to.
Right.
Yeah.
What about thinking in terms of what we have and what we might, I'm not at the
right,
big point, because I'm a big on foreign language in the elementary school too, I think. But what about adding to what we have? So for example, we're so highly focused on science and bringing more engineering and so forth into the elementary schools. What about expanding on that program? What about expanding? We don't necessarily have to come up with something new, but where science, where STEM is at the forefront of everybody's minds. Is there anything that we can do budget-wise that would so we could strengthen our programs?
We do
we
30
need
hours,
resources.
Right?
I think the other part of it is, and this ties in, but you and I have had the discussion, these are small things, the supplies issue, you know, and having one person who can move things around takes a lot of pressure off of the teachers, gives them more time to dedicate to the substance of the class. So improving what we have is supposed to be necessary, I think, is there?
Mm-hmm. We do the 30 hours, except for the 8th grade, computer science and engineering, right?
Right, so, well, yes. All kids in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade get 30 days of engineering and 30 days of computer science in addition to the regular science.
Interest in expanding it to 40 days or any benefit from adding to that?
Right. Well, so the number of days is related to how many days there are in a trimester, and you know, so we'd have to. I mean, we would love to expand. We'd have to look at what that means in terms of schedule and yeah.
Yeah, and we're just sort of brainstorming.
Yeah. No, I hear you.
Because that's a unique thing that very few systems offer.
It is
at that level.
It is. I think that one of the things that we have been thinking about, and I don't know that we have an answer yet, is, you know, we're piloting coding and robotics in grade 3 this year, which has been really neat. And we would love to figure out a way that we create continuity between the experience in grade 3 and then grade 6. Right? And right now, we're doing the grade 3 coding through our specials program, and because of the way performing arts is scheduled in grades 4 and 5, we haven't figured out a good way to do that. But that's a place that I would like to see.
And the towns that have been doing coding in the third grade, you know, there are some.
Mm-hmm.
I think they've been doing it every year.
Could be.
You know, Woodline, I know, is very heavy into it.
Mm-hmm.
And is that another possibility of continuing with that right up to the sixth grade?
Yep, we're thinking about that.
So this isn't so much an ask, but I'd like to take a hard look this year at the other non-personnel costs.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been asking about this for the last year about, like last year came up in the conversation, there was money in utilities, but actually it's being spent on maintenance. I'd like to actually take a look at that other. I know it actually adds up, because if we can find money there, we can actually allocate it to personnel.
Yes, and Heath has taken a look at that issue and actually written something to me about
okay,
it.
Perfect.
And so in December, we
perfect.
Can give you some specific information. And one of the things that we've been doing internally too, I think to your point,
yeah.
is that we really took this opportunity of the transition with me to say, let's go back and do like a 3-year look back at our actuals in every line item,
right.
and you know, make sure that we're budgeting in a way that accurately reflects what
yeah.
gets spent in reality, and you know what we see over time. So I think that you're going to be seeing some adjustments in line
okay.
items and how they're budgeted.
Yeah, so the budget will reflect.
So I want to see that, but also then I want to see if there's. I get you have to heat the building. That's not. Discretionary, but if there's other things that actually are more actually discretionary that we have, I'd love to have that discussion
yes.
as part of the overall budget.
Yeah.
the J term if there's no funding available from outside, you know.
Yeah.
As a.
Yeah, so interest, yes, I'm thinking about that, definitely.
And the same thing, not that you don't do this, but also on personnel, and again, this is, not that you don't do this, but as people retire or people leave the district, again, of course, the gym teacher leaves at elementary school, you need a gym teacher, but just thinking, are there times where you say, you know what, well, maybe we don't need to backfill that position? Not that you don't do that, but just, it's hard to know because you don't always know where people are tricked. And again, that generally you're gonna have to backfill because there's a need, but there might be some, you know, positions you might say, you know what, as you go through this process, if this person retired or left, we don't actually need to backfill. Particularly as you think about demographic shifts, right? We're at the peak in the middle school, but in 3 years we're gonna have 120 students left. I mean, so not that we, you know, maybe this class is too big now, but thinking about the demographics as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we usually take those as part of the budget process.
Yeah.
You'll see, you know, we take a teacher in elementary, the class sizes are going down.
Mm-hmm.
Or we reallocate that position somewhere else.
We have been doing exactly that. We've reallocated to different
right.
levels in the system, and we will absolutely take a look at that again. We are in an interesting moment because the middle school, we got to the point where enrollment went up and we literally didn't have any rooms.
Right.
And so, whereas had we had the space, we might have added
right.
staff, we didn't. And so, I don't know how much opportunity there's going to
okay.
be
yeah.
there. But rest assured, we will take a hard look at that.
What about, so last year was the first year that we expanded on semester courses in high school. Was it last year?
First
2 years.
It's been 2 years. It's
been
2 years.
Oh my, we're at the something. It's already 2 years.
Yeah.
So, is there any interest in further expansion in that way? Are there more?
Yeah. So that's an interesting question. And actually, I've taken a quick peek at the budget requests that are coming out of the high school, and I am seeing
more
social
options.
Studies for that reason in the request. We haven't gotten to the point of looking at that request in the light of all the other requests, but we will.
Is the student independent study initiative expanding? Because I know it's gone from 9 to 40 the last.
Yeah.
And there's a need for support.
It actually, the number of students participating in the program this year decreased pretty significantly from the year before. And, you know, it's one of the things that's tricky about the budget process and things like those kinds of very elective programs that students won't be doing their course selection until February. And we're going to have to make some best guesses about our.
So last year we did a lot of innovative things in the middle school to go from part-time to full-time science people. And,
mm-hmm.
and how do you get at the disabled students? The dust is settling, but as it does, is there a need for more people, another half person, or, you know, it was kind of rushed through last year at the last, but, you know, does that need more work or more attention or more people, based on what we've learned from this year?
Yeah. That's something I know the middle school student services department head has been thinking about the model for teaching some of our kids who are in sub-separate programs, so kids with more significant learning needs in science, and wanting to see if she can steal a section with a science teacher and have a co-taught class. So that's something we might be able to pull up in the context of. So that's the kind of thing that we think would really help and support kids.
Are you planning to come to us in December with a list of things that you'd like to have, but
I have to say, I don't know by our December meeting. I'll look at my own calendar right now. We are meeting as a district leadership team at the beginning of December. In that process, what has happened is that each cost center leader will submit their own request.
Mm-hmm.
And then December 5th will be the first time that the whole team sees what everybody else has asked for, right? So we have a big discussion at that point, and we start weighing priorities, and you know, everybody kind of makes the case and understands other people's needs. And so I'm not sure where we'll be in that process by the next meeting.
Yeah, well, the previous meeting we did get like languages in comparative school systems
mm-hmm.
when they begin.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be worth looking at again and,
yep.
and see if there's any sense of interest. You know, I mean, there's no sense doing it if no one really has a lot of studies, but that would be valuable. I think it's
The thing about foreign language is that we've been talking about that for years, right?
Right.
And for years we've been talking about
should we put it into the lower levels? And the comments that we've always heard from the educators is that they really only study the culture, and it's really not that substantial course. But I don't think that's true. I'm watching some of what I'm seeing with my grandchildren, and they're getting, it's pretty, I mean, I think they have classes 3 times a week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, so I'll tell you that, you know, what we found in our language review is that some programs that say have half an hour a week.
Yeah.
That when we looked at outcomes, and by that I mean by the time you're leaving the system, where are you in terms of your proficiency level?
Is that more?
Yeah, kids aren't becoming more proficient in Spanish because they studied half an hour a week in third grade as compared to our situation.
But that's what we've heard for years. Is that still true? Has it changed? I guess that's
it was still true as of the last time we did a curriculum.
Which is when?
It was 2012, I think.
So?
Yeah, so we can look at that. Now, 3 times a week, that might be different. I mean, 3 times a week at every grade.
I don't know, I just,
okay, I'm just telling you, like, I'm doing the back of the envelope math in my head right now on what that would mean.
The characters of Mandarin, and I thought, oh my goodness.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will.
She's getting it right.
But I will absolutely look into that. I will say that when I said that we're really thinking about our district goals, I mean, clearly we have a science, engineering, coding focus, right? We're about that right now. And the other thing that we're really thinking about is social emotional learning. Mm-hmm. And so that is a big part of the budget discussion for us as well.
So you don't want us throwing other things
away. I'm just telling you where our thinking is.
Okay.
All right, so let's talk about the last, we have 4 minutes left in this segment, about the fees.
Fees, okay.
Yeah. So I'm just going to do a preamble, but then I'm going to ask Pete to say a couple words. So the question was sort of what are we taking into fees, and specifically we were looking at kindergarten tuition. And I think one of the reasons we're looking at kindergarten is that it feels like kindergarten is part of our core academic program,
right?
As opposed to say our athletic fees, not that athletics are clearly important, right? But in terms of our core academic mission.
Right.
And we also had taken a look at what was happening in other communities in Massachusetts around full-day kindergarten tuition. And what we find is that we're certainly in the minority in the state in terms of districts that are charging for full-day kindergarten. And even in our tech group, over the last 3 years, at least 3 tech communities have stopped charging kindergarten tuition. So we want to take a look at that. And so I asked Heath to put together a couple of options for how we might go about that. And what I'm hoping to find out from the committee is, do you want us to consider either one of those options as we build the budget this year? Or even maybe how high a priority is that as we're developing the budget? And after we take a look at all the requests and think about the varying priorities, I can come back and give you an honest recommendation about whether or not I think we can do it this year in light of other things.
I think we should consider. I think these fees are annoying.
They are annoying.
You know, we put this kindergarten fee in years ago in the midst of a budget crisis because we were just, you know, grasping at ways to close the gap. I mean, fortunately, both the town and us are in a little bit better position now. I'll note that when I'm at the town meeting the other night, we're spending $250,000 to study whether we should put a sidewalk in Charlie's yard. Times have changed a bit. I mean, before we were, you know, looking for every penny we could, and we imposed this fee. And I think kindergarten is obviously part of our school program, and I'd be very much in favor of reducing it. If it has to be in stages over 4 years, so be it. I didn't see any. Totally, you totaled up what the kindergarten fees yield is about $340,000. Mm-hmm. I didn't see, so the bus fees about $1 a day, $180. I didn't see what
our
that
our offset for the bus fee is $220,000 a year.
$220,000.
Yeah.
And then I guess my next question is the sports fees.
Sports fees is $280,000.
$280,000.
Yep.
I think we should start. One, right?
What's your sports fee? We won't have any money.
I'm sorry, so the sports fee is what?
$280,000.
$280,000 for the sports. I think on the kindergarten, the thing that struck me is, out of 349 districts, 80% are free. Okay, so that's, Brian has said, we did this under duress, you know, we needed to do it. So I would, I'd strongly recommend looking into 0.26% of the budget, you know, by eliminating over a period of, say, 3 years. So, what are those options that you proposed?
Okay, so option number one is we would eliminate the fee next year altogether for people paying. And we would use the revolving balance to offset the little increases. As the budget increased, we'd be using more of the offset until the offset is gone and the budget is increased to fill that.
So it'd be 0.26 for 3 years, basically.
Yes, 0.26 for 3 years. Under the reduction, under option two, it's $450 a year. You reduce that over the course of that, those number of years until the $1,800 is eliminated. But in the meantime, you're just reducing it, so you still have funds coming in, but it lengthens the time that you have the funds that you currently have.
Which means that the overall, the increase to the operating budget,
so
you know, given this,
0.13.
So, I mean, I'm a good actor, I want it gone. That's my view, and I want it gone next year, ideally, because I think it would be clean, and, I mean, that's my view. We can discuss it, but I think, you know, I think the 80% is one data point. I think the fact that it's now the normal is a second. And the third thing is when we have the conversation with the town, this is giving money back to the people in town. I know they always pick on us. This is almost like, you know, and so we should just, I want to have, the other conversation I want to have with them is, over the next 3 years, we're going to be, you know, it's going to be 0.26 a year of getting money back to town, so we should make they understand that as well. But that's my view, so.
I mean, I think that's a fair view. I would suggest if we reduce it gradually, maybe we could spread the reductions around and make the sports fees go from 250 to 200, with the cap 750 to 600, so more people benefit if we're going to.
Yeah, but then what do you do? Keep you're keeping something for the kindergarten fee? Because
he's got two proposals, right? One is wipe it out.
Yeah.
Two is eliminate it gradually.
Yeah.
So if you eliminate the, you start eliminating the kindergarten fee gradually, you start eliminating the sports fee gradually, you know.
Okay, so for instance, the athletics fee, I just happened to pull this up, we did it 2 years ago for athletics fees. So if you reduce the athletic fee about $50,
yeah,
that's basically a 0.13% increase to the budget as well.
And each percent is about $430,000,
yeah,
is that right?
Well, you said the total we got from athletic fees is $280,000. Right?
Yes.
The total we're getting from kindergarten is $340,000, right?
Yeah, but there's some money in the athletic revolving account. Like we were offsetting some of that cost from what's in the kindergarten revolving account.
Well, putting aside the offsets, I mean, what we raise, the kindergarten fee is $340,000. What we raise with the sports fee is $280,000. So it's just an idea. I mean, if you want to start reducing cost fees in general, that would be the second fee you could gradually reduce. I don't know how you gradually reduce the bus fee. It's already, it's just, it's the bus the public day.
How long has it been since we've had the athletic fee? Has it been?
Oh, it's been a long time.
So the only thing I worry about is sustainability.
That's what I want.
Everybody
would love to get rid of all the fees.
Right.
But what happens when we hit a snag?
Talking about getting down from 250 to 200, 750 to 600, and you can gradually reduce the kindergarten.
And so, Brian, I mean, I certainly hear your point that it might spread around the impact of more people. And I think that's an important point. My concern around the kindergarten fee in particular is that, you know, the idea behind kindergarten tuition is you pay the kindergarten tuition if you want your kid to go to a full day program as opposed to a half day program. The reality is that
that's
in Westwood,
a mirage. I agree.
Everyone's going full day, and we only have full day classes.
Right.
I mean, to say we have a half day program option, I think is an overstatement.
And so it feels important to me to sort of acknowledge that reality, I guess, and get rid of.
I don't disagree with that.
I'm with Tony. I think we get rid of the kindergarten, see how it goes, but.
But then next year, the sports fees.
Gradually. The issue of the preschool, if I could ask, that's just kids, what, 3 or 4 years old or something?
Yeah, and I would say that as distinct from the kindergarten tuition, preschool tuition, that's very common.
We're $10,000, okay? And the towns that we compare ourselves with average $6,400. So the issue is, so we look at the high end of that.
You have a better program, Chad.
We're awesome.
We do have an awesome program.
I think that's relatively inexpensive.
That's what I would say, that relative.
Private nurseries.
Yeah, because how many kids are in our preschool now? 50.
50
kids. You know, most preschool-age children in Westwood are attending private preschools, and our tuition relative to the cost of attending a private preschool, it's a bargain.
So should we make a motion?
I just wanted guidance. So I think what I'm hearing is, yes, we are interested in seriously considering this nature of the kindergarten fee. Okay, that's very helpful.
All right.
Thanks for putting all the data together. It makes it much easier to decide on this.
And I would ask, just for question purposes for next time, I'd like to know, what would that reduction mean on the sports fee? You go from 250 to 200, cap at 600 out of 750. It's not eliminating it, but reducing it. Mm-hmm. Which is what Norwood, I think, has.
Okay. Good discussion, people.
Oh, Stephen.
5 minutes over, though, so we have to next week. Building project engagement. Building project community engagement plan. So, Tony and Emily and I, you were there too. We met to figure out, we sort of synthesized, well, actually, Emily really came up with a good summary of and a good schedule of what we want to do based on our last conversation at our last school committee meeting. So we have it in here, right?
Yes.
The engagement plan is listed in here. If everybody had a chance to take a look at that, does anyone have any comments on that plan?
That looks pretty complicated.
Well, so I tried to take the action steps that we discussed last month and really think about what is the logical order for these things and to attach some dates to them so that we have benchmarks to hit along the way. So as you remember, our phase one was in form, and we said we'd be doing that between December and February. We had articulated objectives there, and so I have a whole host of steps here that we would begin to undertake in December. And I have started work on some of these things. So for example, one of the things that we talked about is working with Westwood Media Center to create some kind of a video that would inform people about the state of the buildings and our needs. And I've reached out to Melinda Garfield there, and she is very enthusiastic about working on that with us starting next month. So those kinds of things. The idea being that we would be able to launch our web page related to the capital project in early January, in time to send out the letter to all residents of Westwood in January 15th. Right? So this is all the inform phase. And then our second phase that we talked about was the listen phase, where we engage in a visioning process with the community to develop the criteria that we would use when assessing various building project options. And so I've started to attach real dates to these things, that we would conduct a series of community forums led by the school committee. And I've articulated three dates for that in March, that we would conduct focus groups at all of our PTO meetings, at CPAC, at the Early Childhood Council. And I have spoken with the PTO president's group and started establishing dates for those meetings, focus groups with educators, And this would all sort of be leading to, in April, distributing some kind of electronic survey for community members after we've had the in-person forums and discussion. And that sort of as far as we've gotten in terms of specific dates. We know what phase three and four will be, but we have this parallel process happening here with the MSBA process. And so the timelines for phases three and four will differ depending on what news we get for next month. So you can see on the plan, we've kind of got the, if we get our statement of interest accepted, we will be doing all kinds of other things in collaboration with MSBA while we're doing our own community engagement. And if we don't get that statement of interest accepted, then we would be on a different timeline for that process, presumably looking to this April to resubmit.
Right.
So I'm kind of leaving those different routes open.
Okay.
At this point.
It's a robust plan, right?
What's the history like of course turned down the first time, resubmitted, is it
yeah,
a chance of getting it the second time?
Yeah, there's a very good chance of getting it the second time. We're aware of many communities that have submitted multiple times until they were accepted. And by the way, I'm just thinking at our last meeting, we asked, you know, what other communities have gotten accepted in with MSBA, and I see that Lexington, Needham, Winchester, I mean, these are all communities that are currently engaged with MSBA.
One thing, I don't know if anybody's interested in, but I'd be very interested in hearing from other school committees and from administration. As we're going out meeting with people, talking to people, you may have at a soccer game 2 minutes with somebody. What's a good elevator speech to, to describe what is the problem? You know, I don't think I even know the best way to do it. I'd love to hear everyone else's ideas. So what's the best 2 minute, 5 minute, 10 minute statement of the problem that we're taking on? Number two, I'm beginning to think about the same, you know, 2 minute, 5 minute, 10 minute options that are out there, that, you know, worth looking at, considering it, getting feedback on that. The third thing it's worth doing is quietly finding out where the opposition is, because there's a lot of people in this town don't want to, they want the money from Westwood Station back in their pocket. You know, so there's going to be opposition no matter what. You know, we're going to have to go through town. So it's worth our while beginning ourselves to share with each other, learn from each other about, you know, what we need to be aware of.
Yeah, I agree. I think that that's really important work for December. I mean, you see the first thing up there is developing written materials, but I would add to that also just, you know, being clear that we have common talking points about, you know, what we need to communicate to people in December. And, you know, right after Thanksgiving, I think we need to start that work. And to your second point, for our December meeting, I've asked Pam Dukeman, who's the town finance director, to present to school committee about Westwood Station, you know, revenue from Westwood Station, kind of the financial impact of Westwood Station, and we'll get a sense of that.
It'd be worth asking Pam also, if for some reason we weren't going to ever get money, you know, what could be borrowed? What's the credit for the town? What competitive project she hears about, other than people want to build things.
Right.
But, you know, that would be good getting a flavor for.
Yeah.
You know, say, don't expect anything more from the town than this. But that could be an option.
Yeah, I will ask Pam to talk a bit. I mean, I've had some private conversations with her about, for instance, like where we are with the debt on this building and when the debt's going to fall off on this building. I mean, all of those things are important things for us to be communicating with, you know, with the town about those things, and also be able to be articulate and explain that to community members too, what are the implications. So I will absolutely.
We don't have any more intel when the MSBA is going to issue their.
No, they have no new intel. They've told us is by the end of the calendar year. So.
Let's
see. So if this looks reasonable, we're like full steam ahead on this, and
Nice. Okay, great.
Okay, we're down to action items. Can I get a motion to approve the minutes from October 11th? Second, any discussion? No, all in favor? Okay, the class size guideline policy, this is, we just discussed this in our last meeting. This is the first reading of the new guideline.
So this is exactly what we discussed last month.
Right. So
we don't have to read it, do we?
We don't. No. We want to wait. We can waive the first reading.
Do you want a motion to waive the first reading?
Yes.
I'd like to make that.
Second, all in favor? Okay. All right. Reauthorization of the anti-bullying and intervention plan. This plan has not changed. So unless there's...
I just had a question. I mean, we don't need to do it. Is there something in the policy around multiple incidents with a particular aggressor? Or is it...
Yeah.
There is. Oh, maybe I didn't see it. I'll take a look at it.
The existence of a pattern is a key issue in the analysis.
Okay, that's right. That's another question. I didn't have time before.
Nope, that's right. Yeah.
How much of an issue has this been? Is there...
So we use this all the time as a reference point. We do a lot of investigating. There's often not bullying found, but conflict among kids that's very real. And when there is bullying found, we actually substantiate that in a letter to both the aggressor and the target's family, and we put in place support plans. And it does occasionally happen.
So are the kids educated about
this
policy?
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
It's expected.
Well, part of the policy itself outlines what we do in terms of educating kids. It's not about like the policy, right? But to educate them about what bullying is and how to be, you know, a good bystander. And so we have curriculum in place at all levels.
An ongoing.
That.
So we need a motion, right?
Yes.
So, second?
Second.
Any more further discussion? Okay, all in favor? Tony?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Okay. All right. Moving on to the next item. This is the Thurston Middle School 8th grade trip to Washington, D.C. repeat performance. This is what our fourth year. So we have to, they're looking for approval to this trip.
Yes. So the details of the trip are included in your packet.
Does anyone want to make a motion?
I just wanted to thank you for checking with our police people on anything we should be aware of about sending our kids places and security and all that. Thank you for asking. It's a very different world out there, and a large number of kids going to. I think it's good that our police are aware and they give us feedback.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. No, for any further discussion? No? Okay. All in favor? Okay, send those kids to Washington. Off you go. All right. This change to the, this is supposed to be the 2018-19 school
yes,
calendar.
Yes, I'm sorry. I hope it didn't cause any alarm. We're not changing this year's calendar, so.
So this is just the addition of the day?
Yeah, so I had some communication with Dottie Powers, who's Westwood's town clerk, and she has asked that the school department consider closing the district on November 6th, 2018 for Election Day. It's a state election, and apparently turnout is expected to be large, and our polling places are in schools. She's been in touch with some surrounding communities, and most districts are apparently closing on that day.
I have some challenges with this.
Yes. Okay.
The first one is there's actually three elections next year. There's the town election in April, there's a primary in September,
mm-hmm.
and there's this one.
Mm-hmm.
So my issue, if it's a matter of safety, then we're being not consistent here.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you have strangers walking into the schools, each of those. So if it's a safety issue, that's one challenge. If it's something else, so that's one, it's not being consistent. Second, it's disruptive. I think Tuesdays are just taking Tuesdays off are disruptive to the school week.
Mm-hmm.
And third, I don't understand. I know that they're gonna look at this. The schools exist for education, not to serve. The primary mission is education,
mm-hmm.
not electoral civics.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'd like to see the town clerk take a real hard look at getting these out of the schools.
And that has, I have initiated that conversation.
Okay.
So Dottie and I have talked about that, and we're both in agreement that moving the polling places out of the schools is a good idea. We need to move forward on that. My sense from talking to her is that she doesn't think that she can make that happen by November 6th of next year.
Yeah, but to Tony's other point,
yeah.
why is this
update and for and what.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, I don't know that I have tremendous insight into that. This was the only date that the request was about. I don't have much insight into what voter turnout is.
Yeah, maybe it's a volume issue.
I don't know.
I think it's a volume. It's funny because you're right. You have strangers going in. Well, strangers. Well, hopefully not strangers. It's people from the town.
Yes.
But I think of it more from traffic in right because there were some incident. There were a couple right kids who were in the parking lots.
Not here.
In other towns. So I think that's really where this.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
It's the best way to go, but I think that's really what it's about volume,
yeah,
not necessarily
maybe.
About strangers in the school.
But you don't know what the volume
we
will be towards a town election.
We don't.
I think before we change it,
we should get a little more intel on it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's any urgency
right.
on this
yeah.
issue.
And I mean, I would like to put a little pressure. I mean, it's not that hard to figure out where there could be other alternatives. I'd like to have a little pressure that we're not in 6 years.
I think you make a good point. What is the difficulty, seriously,
yeah.
in moving it? You have the senior center,
the
town hall, the library.
Churches. I mean, I don't know. Is it in community center? I don't know if they're feasible.
It's not on you, but
we have to go back.
If we can find out from Johnny what the process
yeah.
really involves, because
right.
it would be nice not to have to.
Yes.
And we were so excited to have voted the school calendar
yes.
number two.
That's
so
another
thing.
I know. Well, the best laid plans.
Okay.
All right. So we'll hold off on that for now.
Yeah.
And the ratification of the instructional assistance contract.
Yeah. So you may remember that last spring I came to you with a memorandum. And the committee voted to ratify that contract. It subsequently got voted down by the IA's bargaining unit, and so we were back at the table this fall. And we now have a memorandum of agreement that they have, in fact, ratified. The only difference is the language around Article 8 sick leave. And we just needed to change the language to really clarify the use of the sick leave to care for family members.
Okay. You want a motion?
I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to accept the revised memorandum of agreement between the West Oakland Schools and the Instructional and Library Assistance Unit.
Okay, do I have a second? Okay, all in favor? All right, thank you.
Thank you.
So, that's it, folks.
Do we have public participation?
We had it earlier.
Yeah, I know, so.
So we can.
I can't remember
so
what
the issue. So the issue came up last,
right.
I think we were talking.
Right.
So the history is, originally, years ago, we
right.
had one.
Yeah.
Right? Then
we
went
two.
To two. And then we said, well, we decided to go back to one because it was interrupting flow and,
right.
and
yeah.
time, and it felt like those who were presenting at the end were really, I mean, at night, it was getting late and so forth. So Tony mentioned, well, why not do it before the action items? And so that's why we had it earlier tonight. However, I mean, if you all, if you don't want to adjourn and you want to, we can open it up now.
I don't know. Is there anybody that wants
it's,
to?
We're 8 minutes even before. We're actually early. I wish Brian were here to see it. I'm happy to open it
somebody
up to.
We have someone over here.
Public participation if you'd like to take a minute. And
thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. Elaine Hashman, 144 Briar Lane. I just want to take a minute to speak to the current third grade at Martha Jones. I have to say that it's going really well. This is that big class size at Martha Jones this year. We started the year with 24 kids. We added the aide. I just was late because I was at a parent conference there. I have to say I'm thrilled with the teacher. She knows my kid to a T. Come November, I couldn't be happier. The administration did a really good job of splitting the classes nicely. So a lot of the problems we had last year with the big numbers are alleviated by all that forethought that went into it. She's going really well. So thank you for all of that. That said, the 25th student is joining the class next week, so it is continuing to grow, and although I'm happy with the way it's turned out now, it's big and it seems to be getting bigger. There are many houses still in the market in the Martha Jones zone that haven't sold yet, or maybe sale pending, we don't think he's coming. There's a chance that might not affect us, but there's a chance that it will, and I just want to keep that on the forethought as we go into the budget for next year. You know, if things remain the same, maybe we can keep the same plan. It is working well, but if things keep growing, we might need to consider another choice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Anyone else?
This is it. Okay, with no further public
motion to adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Are you sure?
Okay.
Thank you.
We still, I think we were all in favor. All right, have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.